We have a treat for you this morning. Before we go into our testimony time and all that, first, I just want to tell you that yesterday was our restoration conference, and it went amazing. And God did some amazing things yesterday. It was a long day. And for those of you, you might not know, but when you're praying and you're interceding and you're doing that for 8 or 9 hours, it can be very spiritually tasking. So there's a lot of fried people here this morning. So yesterday, imagine, because of my responsibility, so you can understand why we're doing what we're doing today. With my responsibility and my lead role, yesterday would amount to, okay, you know when we have a healing and I pray for people and I might pray for people up here at the altar for like an hour? This was like 8 hours of that for me yesterday. And there has to be a limit on a person's body in the Lord. So like, let's say I went to do some services somewhere, I would not be able to give out my whole 8 hours worth in one night, right? I would have to spread it out over several services to minister, because God's anointing is always there and his strength is always there, but he also calls us to obey rest. And so once again, last week, part four was moved because the Holy Spirit moved last week and we did an altar call and we had prayer time, and God just dramatically worked on people's lives last week. And he told me, you know, there's stuff that needs taken care of today. So you're not preaching your message. And I was like, okay, I'm going to be obedient to that. And well, this week, this morning, in my prayer time, I said, Lord, you know that yesterday was like me doing an 8-hour healing service. And I'm fried, you know. And I will not preach unless, not always, because sometimes he has to give me the ability if I'm sick or whatever. I will preach anyway because the Holy Spirit is my strength. But this morning, I told him, I know I have limits, and the words you've given me for the last part of High Above It All, I want to present it well. If you haven't noticed, I have very little voice. I'm struggling to have my voice. This is like a lot of tea this morning to make. I woke up without a voice. So yesterday was a very, very, very wonderfully amazing and dramatic restoration conference. And I had to do a little bit of removing some demons, and there was some, I had to get a little loud with them. They had to go bye-bye. So I lost my voice a little bit. And then this morning I was trying to sing and there was nothing. I was just like, okay, wow, really? And I was like, ah, I'm not going to let you hear it. And I was like, okay, Lord, so I will present my message when I can present it well and not be up here a mangled mess, you know, trying to present. Live high above it all while I'm up here and I have no voice and I'm fried. No, I'm just kidding. So I felt like we already knew we were going to have testimonies of those who walked through deliverance yesterday and were a part of the restoration conference. So we have a few that are going to come up and share what God did in their life yesterday. And a couple people could not be here, but they have told me what God did, and they told me that they would like me to share it. And after that, we are going to watch a short video. It's going to be about 26 minutes. Who here likes John Bevere? I love John Bevere. He's amazing. I can trust him. And this morning when I was asking the Lord, well, what do you want me to present as a message if I'm not going to preach this message, because I want to be all here when I present a message. So, and he basically told me, number one of Relentless. And if you haven't been here on Wednesday night, that is the Wednesday night class that we're doing. And we are on week 6 of a 12-week thing. But the first one, he told me, was such an eye-opener that today is a day for Relentless. So you're going to get to see the very first teaching and preaching he did on Relentless. And it's only about 25 minutes. It's short because it's supposed to be a part of, you know, the group that we do. So they're not long. And so it works out good, actually, because evidently whoever's in this room, God needs you to hear the message of Relentless. And his introduction message is, will rock your socks. Nobody's wearing socks because it's like summer. Rock your sandals off. yeah. So it's going to blow your mind. It's going to wreck your mind for a moment. And evidently, God thinks you need that today. And we needed to have time for testimonies. So I would like to ask those to prepare themselves to come on up and just line up here on my left side. Those that have already said that they're willing to share this morning. I knew we would need at least 15 minutes for this, so then the short video works out good for your teaching part. So while they're preparing to come up and make their way, I also wanted to mention this, and I feel like this is a plea that I need to do. And if you're watching by Facebook, you know, I hope you hear this too. But as you know, we love that we have faithful tithers. We have those of you that give on a regular basis. We wouldn't be able to do what we're doing here and do the ministry we're doing without faithful tithing. There is a worship intensive school that is happening. It's a few days of a school, and we would like to send Pastor Matt, most of all, to this school to continue his gifting. As you know, who doesn't need more school in the area where you're called, right? And we would also love to possibly have a way to send other worship team members to go to this worship intensive. Now, I know some of you might not understand the importance of this, but I don't know if any of you know that Pastor Matt, he has the gift of prophetic worship. So like he can tell in the spirit what's going on, and then God will just give him a song in the moment. You notice how he does that? Some of those songs are his. They're just ones God gives him in the spirit in the moment. And it's something he feels you guys need to hear, and he's singing it prophetically over you. Well, that's a gift. That's a special gift above worship. Well, this conference, you guys aren't probably going to know who these people are, but Rick Pino and Jason Upton are doing this worship school, and it's an intensive where they're going to get hit hard for like 2.5 days, which is boom, 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 boom. And it's in Austin, Texas. And we really want to send Pastor Matt. But for us to send him, even if he drives, it's about $400 for him to, about $600 for him to go, including the rental car. And it was cheaper to do it that way than flying. We've tried every which way, but that ended up being the most affordable. And so, and anyone else on the worship team that we could send, we would love to do that. But it is $400 per person for this school. And I know that sounds like, wow, that's a lot of money. Yes, I know. But precisely why the church, because we're small, we cannot afford to send everybody like that. We don't have that in our budget. And so, but most of all, we would like to send Pastor Matt if we can't send anybody else. Because Rick Pino is like one of, if those of you who don't know him, he is like one of the main worship leaders in the entire world that is prophetic, and his whole ministry is prophetic worship. And people like that you've seen at Revival, Nathan Morris, any of the other big-time revivalists that you have seen, they will do conferences, Holy Spirit conferences, and people like Rick Pino will be the ones that are there during the worship. And so he is the real deal, and his school is the real deal. And just as we do our classes every week, and you guys are growing and learning, and you're becoming relentless, and you're learning how to live beyond your feelings, and we have all this stuff that the church provides for you, well, sometimes our pastors need to be able to go and get some training. And we would love to send him. So, and the other worship members, if we're able to, if somehow miraculously we could do that. And so I am putting a plea out today. If you feel like you can help sponsor at all for Pastor Matt to go, please, you know, write out a check, put on there to sponsor Matt's the worship school trip or whatever. And make sure Jason gets it, because obviously we already received the tithes and offering. Also, as you know, we have Easy Tithe, the online giving. you can get on there and give, and you can put in the memo that it's for the worship intensive for Pastor Matt or for the worship team. If we receive enough funds, we will try to send more than just Pastor Matt. And so we know that there's other members that would like to go. They live in my house. I know they want to go. They don't want to have to miss out on going, you know, and learning what they can learn there. And so so please consider that. You can give today or just be praying about giving, but it's going to be at least $600 for Pastor Matt to go, and then $400 for each person after that. And so it's kind of like sending kids to camp, but it's the adult worship team. So please, if you can give anything, any little bit helps us to be able to cover the expense for Pastor Matt to go and the rest of the team to be able to go. Anyway, so moving on. Are you going to be able to make it? Okay. This is questionable up here. Yeah, so she's already wrecked. Well, she's been wrecked since yesterday. But I will go ahead and we'll let Haley start. I have one that was sent to me, somebody that had done, Joyce Winkler had done it, but she had to go back home to Cottonwood. So she could not be here this morning, but she did text me her testimony and she would like me to share it. So I will share that, but I'm going to let these guys go ahead and share what God did in their life yesterday at the Deliverance Conference.
Hello, good morning. Thank you. So I have this long testimony of being saved and then being raised in a house where we were Christian and we went to church, but my parents were addicts and there was a lot of, do I need to talk like this? Okay. My parents were addicts and so there was a lot of abuse in the house, and so I kind of grew up with like a distorted view on who Jesus even was and what God's role in everything was. And so then I had an encounter with the Holy Spirit and then was called back here, and I wasn't able to do the one in January. And it didn't feel like I was ready for that yet. And so going into it yesterday, I had to wait my turn, and so I was sitting out here for like an hour, and I'm just sitting there and I'm like, why am I waiting? What is the purpose in me waiting? Because God has a reason for everything. And so I'm just waiting there, and he's like just encouraging me and letting me know that I am ready. And so I, can I share who I was with? Okay, sorry, I didn't know if that was. So I was with Miss Tammy, and she prayed over me for a specific thing that was very heavy on me, and I literally, like, the tears filled my eyes, and as soon as I was done, I looked at her, and I was like, I feel like I have new eyes. Like, I could literally see differently. Like, the heaviness was just gone, and then even yesterday, I was so tired when I got home, but it was, like, a peaceful tired? I don't know how to explain it, and I slept really good. So if you ever want a good night's sleep, just do restoration, because you'll sleep like a baby. But yeah, I literally feel like God just, he's so graceful with me. He's such a gentleman, and he just took me through it in such a way where every single thing that I got prayed on for, I could just feel it leaving. And then when I opened my eyes, I was like, ooh, this is what life is like. This is how he wants us to live it. So yes, free. So yeah.
How do you top that? Yeah, I know. I've been kind of like on a journey through my freedom and stuff. God's given me like visions throughout all this, because a lot of stuff I've had buried deep inside me from my childhood and my past. And a lot of it I didn't realize I had buried it so deep that I didn't realize it was there. And I had to go back over like from the beginning, from when I was born, all the way back to there. And it's like, as I was going along the way, God would stop me and go, we have to break this off now. And the more and more I went along my life, I just kept breaking off more and more of it. Even though it had to be repeated several times. I think that's all.
When I went through that yesterday, as Jason was praying for me, it took Zach and Jason to hold me down because I wanted to leave. And last night when I got home, I had a vision where God told me to pick up his cross in my front yard and drag it around Rainbow Valley for days. I mean days, day and night, 24 hours a day. He said he had a place for that cross, but I never did find the correct place. I just threw the cross and I left. It's something for you guys all to go through. Jeez, it'll change your mind.
Amen. Thank you. So what's so important for you to understand is every testimony is so amazing, but I'll tell you this, nobody that goes through restoration regrets it. And we even had a teen go through it yesterday. So, you know, we recommend that you're, you know, like 14 and up if you're going to do it, because it's serious. I mean, it's some serious stuff going on in this place. So you need to be a little bit of an older teen. But just like Kurt, all I can tell you is the particular strong man, stronghold demon that they were trying to get rid of at that moment, it was not going to give up. It was not going to let go of him, and there was some fight, and then Pastor Zach had to come over and hold him down and for them to bring deliverance in that one area. And so it was an amazing day yesterday. Every person that was a part of it had something dramatic happen. And so I'm here to tell you, this restoration ministry is dead serious, you guys. The Lord will meet you here. He will remove stuff. And Gabby said it perfectly. He had to take her. This is her second time going through. He had to take her back to her when she was born till now. And he was before she came to restoration yesterday, he was already dealing with her about stuff and preparing her and reminding her of things in her past that she had not dealt with, even though she had done deliverance once. And so you need to know there's something so wonderful. And I know that it seems scary and some people think it's just not necessary, or maybe you're afraid of it. Whoever did it yesterday, was it? I mean, it was wonderful. It was not like you would never regret doing it ever. And so here's the thing, you know, the Lord has such a wonderful healing for you. Because this is inner healing. This is from your birth until now. Anything that has went on in your life that might have attached to you that you haven't even known. Like, why do I do this same thing over and over? Like, why do I think this way? Why do I treat people this way? Why? It's because most likely there were things that happened to you as a child that need broken off of you. Hurts. Maybe sexual abuse, all that. It all gets broken off of you. And it's simple. Literally, your prayer leader sits with you by yourself and they just pray you through. And they just break stuff off. And they break it off from a list, a deliverance list sheet that I have created for you with the Holy Spirit's guidance. And here's the thing. And it is the Holy Spirit guiding it, because the people that have went through it will tell you. When it came time to do the next stronghold, they knew, and they felt that it needed to leave. They knew that you read off the symptoms, and they're like, "Wow, that's my life." Yeah, So here's the thing. God loves you so much. He loves you so much. And I can't speak for every person that's done it. You will only get out of it what you are ready to get out of it. If you just come ready to say, God, heal me, you're going to get healed. He's going to move in your life. And so I'll just tell you, if you can't tell, I'm very passionate about this ministry. This is a ministry that the Lord gave me, and it was birthed. He created it in me to be birthed. Someday we're going to be getting people from everywhere coming. We have our logo made now. We're figuring out to get more organized and get it to where we can, you know, actually run ads and have people from other churches. They don't need to attend our church to come and get set free. And, you know, they can just come and get restoration if they feel they need that in their life. And so with the help of Tammy typing and my vision, that's how restoration came to be. And I'll tell you, God is in it, you guys. He's in it because people, there's stuff that God will remove from you and he will heal you if you would allow him to. So I'm just going to say this to you for the next one that we're going to have, which will most likely be in January, will be the next one. Between now and then, start preparing yourself. Start allowing God to prepare you for restoration and to be willing to go through it. And like Kurt said it very well, everyone needs to do it. He was never sure about it. He was like, I don't know about that. You know, that could be everybody's response. I don't know about that. And he did want to run, and they had to hold him down. Because the demon wanted to run. But I'll tell you, it's a serious healing when Kurt sits up here and tells you. And then he had a dream. God gave him a prophetic dream last night that he was now carrying the cross. How amazing. And he wasn't the only one. I had other people come to me and say that they had dreams last night. God awakened a whole new thing to them. And it was like stuff just went off and they are like in a whole nother world. So here's one of the other testimony of Joyce Winkler. She said, I had been feeling very tired and weak because of my health. I was feeling like giving up. God told me I was a warrior and he wasn't done with me. Fear, apathy, rejection, sorrow, shame, and heaviness, which are all demonic strongholds that we break off of you. And more was broken off of me. I feel more awake than I have in a long time. The prophetic word that was given to me was spot on. I have victory. Thanks so much for allowing me to go. By the way, and she added this in, you guys won't fully understand this last little part, but by the way, George said he hasn't had a problem with his ear since you prayed for him at the last healing service. For those of you who don't know, Jason's parents were here, and I did the healing service. He came up for his ear, and he said he was healed. So here's the thing. God is real, and he's on the move. He has never stopped moving. And so another testimony we have from yesterday was Andrea Jordan, Joanne Jordan's daughter. She came and told me the testimony this morning. She couldn't be here, but she wanted me to know. But when one of the very first things that we deal with is guilt, shame, and condemnation. And she said, how long has she been having back issues? Forever. Pain, back, problems, whatever. And she said, because I was partnered with her particularly, and she said when guilt, shame, and condemnation was broken off of her, all her pain left. So she was set free from that infirmity just by breaking off guilt, shame, and condemnation and having it broken off of her. I'm telling you, this will rock your world. We're not telling you to do this because, oh, you know, we just want to be the creepy spiritual people. Gosh, you always want to do something to me. come to the altar. Let us pray for you. No, I'm just kidding. Gosh, they gotta be so weird there. We are weird. We're weirdos. Surprise! And we're happy. We're happy weirdos. Here's the thing. God did not just call us to plant a church here. He called us to set people free. And I will not come here every Sunday and preach an awesome message. Sorry. Awesome. Just kidding. Message. Sorry. I'm just being funny. Preach a message to you and have our little, you know, service and let's get some coffee and go on your merry way and go live your life during the week. God didn't call me to do that. He called me to be a chain breaker. And so restoration comes from the vision and heart to see people set free from demonic strongholds. He has put that in my life. It is who I am to do that and to lead people in that. And so that's where restoration came from. And, you know, I will just tell you, if you have not done it, you need to do it. We do not have a sign-up sheet right now because it's going to be a while. The Christmas season is crazy here at the Bridge because we're doing outreaches and stuff, so we won't be doing another one till January. But be thinking about that. Also, be thinking about being baptized. Once you receive Christ, your next step is baptism. I don't have a picture. I should have had it put in the, inserted in there. But we finally have our new shirts, and Pastor Zach created the tagline because we wanted our church to have our own tagline. And we didn't want to copy someone else's, you know, church that says raised to life, even though that's a good one. But they have all these different sayings everyone has, like on their T-shirts. Well, we wanted to create our own. And so through the staff, you know, talking and figuring out and writing down taglines and trying to do it, we came up and we all voted on the one that Pastor Zach came up with. And it says, he rose, we rise. So we're getting shirts made up. We already have them created. And so when you get baptized, our goal is for you to have a shirt to be baptized in that says, he rose, we rise. And our heart also, too, is to get enough shirts that if you have been previously baptized here, we have a shirt for you. You may not get baptized in it because you've already been baptized. If you want to do it again, you can do it again and wear the shirt. we'll dip you. We'll only hold you under for a minute. I'm just kidding. Yeah, start practicing now. Hold your breath 60 seconds. We want to make sure you're good and clean. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But anyway, it was so amazing to see what God did yesterday. And there was other amazing things that he did that I'm not going to talk about from the pulpit, but there was more than just those who went through individual deliverance. And it was an amazing day of work yesterday. And this is why we're fried. And that's how it rolls. So, we love you guys. We're going to get ready to start Relentless. And we will actually probably get out of here at the same time. I thought it might be a little sooner, but that didn't happen. We're going to tear down and just be done because everyone needs a break tonight. We have had a busy, all of our main leaders, most of them are also did the restoration yesterday. And we did the back-to-school bash last week. We've had such a busy 2 weeks. Now, reminder, there's no service next Sunday. We are recommending that you go to Revival, at least one service, because it's Revival weekend, and it is their fifth-year anniversary, going into their fifth year of Revival. So we recommend you at least go to one of those services since we can't have church here. And I think that that's it, but we believe that people need a break tonight. Okay. Oh, Pastor Zach wants to make sure you drink water because we can't put the stuff in there. School starts, so we have to put it in the Connex. It's going to be a hot walk. So, yeah! Woo! We're excited about that. Just kidding. Okay. Okay. I'm going to leave the pulpit and the mic now. Okay, let's watch the video.
I want to welcome you to the taping of Relentless Curriculum. And as you can see, these people are very excited about the Word of God. They are excited about Jesus. We all love the Word of God here. We know you do too. But we have got the most exciting, exciting messages to bring to you. I'm so excited. I can't wait to get going. So before we begin on session one of Relentless, let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you so very much for the privilege of being your children. Lord, tonight I'm asking that you would literally invade this sanctuary. Reveal Jesus to us greater than we've ever known him before. And I'm thanking you that as we behold him, we will go from glory to glory to glory. As by the Spirit of the living God, for I decree your kingdom is within us. Your will shall be done in this place on earth as it is in heaven. And for this we give you the glory and the honor and the praise and the thanksgiving. In Jesus' mighty, wonderful, majestic, awesome, holy, magnificent name. And everybody that agrees shouts amen. Let's thank him one more time for what he's going to give us. Amen. Amen. Well, you can be seated. You know, I want to share with you about a movie that I watched right at the beginning when I was writing this book 10 months ago. The movie is actually an old movie, and it's called The Ghost and the Darkness, and it stars Val Kilmer and Michael Douglas. It's all about a time in the late 1800s when they were building a bridge over the river of Savarro. And the movie starts out with the bridge is behind schedule, and a wonderful engineer is hired to come and make sure that bridge gets completed on time. That is played by Val Kilmer, and the man's name is Patterson. He comes on the scene where they're building the bridge. But what he discovers soon after arriving is that men end up missing during the night. And the story unfolds that they discover that there are two man-eating lions that keeps taking men out. And they try to set traps. They try to do all kinds of things to catch these lions. And they just keep eluding their traps. Well, once the death toll reached 30 men, they brought in an excellent hunter called Remington. He was an American man. This is a true story. And Remington came in, and they began to set traps and hunt the lions, and they kept eluding their traps. Finally, when the death toll got to 130 men by these two lions, the foreman saw a train that was leaving the town and got all of his workmen that were working on the bridge to get on that train and get out of Dodge. Now, this was the life-defining moment of the movie that really impacted me. I'm watching Remington, and I'm watching Patterson and Patterson's age stand there watching all these hundreds of men who were influenced by this man full of fear because of this lions, the foreman. And they all left. And these three men are left to tackle these man-eating lions. Well, I'm not going to go into the whole story, but it turns out after a lot of work, they end up killing the two man-eating lions. And what happens is the men come back, and now the respect for this man, Patterson, is huge by all these workmen. And what this movie showed me is this. We are also building a bridge. We're building a bridge between heaven and earth. We are ambassadors, and we're bringing the kingdom of heaven to this earth. But Peter makes a statement. He says, Satan, as a roaring lion, is seeking whom he may devour. We've got an enemy. But just as those men, they had guns. Those lions didn't have guns. We have weapons, and our enemy has been stripped. Because the Bible says that Jesus has disarmed every principality and power. He says, I've got the keys, he's got the armor, and he's given it to us. So the question is going to be, what kind of people are we going to be? How is our life going to play out? Are we going to be the people that are influenced by the man of fear who runs from adversity? Are we going to be like Remington and like Patterson and Patterson's age who stood and faced those lions and accomplished what they were set out to accomplish? So, in order to introduce this, I want to look at the words of Solomon. Solomon says in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 8, he says, finishing is better than beginning. How many of you know that how we finish is much more important than how we start? That is a good place to say amen. Whether it's a relationship, whether it's an assignment, whether it's a season of our life, or whether it's on our entire life, completion is the most important thing. In order to finish well, we've got to live well. Amen? But due to the fact that there are in this world opposing forces, that means we have to learn how to never give up. It means we have to develop a relentless spirit. Amen? Yes. How do we acquire a relentless spirit? Why is it so important? That is what this curriculum is all about. Developing a relentless spirit and why it's so important. Honestly, I'm going to be just really frank right now. I have a deep concern, and it's been in me for years, that a lot of Christians are not going to finish well. Jesus speaks of it. Paul speaks of it. And we're living in that time period. You know, God gave me a vision that really relates to what I'm sharing with you, and I want to share this vision. I did in an earlier curriculum called Heart Ablaze, but I'm going to elaborate more upon the vision as God has developed it over the years. But in this vision, I saw a man rowing a boat, and he was rowing a typical rowboat against a very swift moving current of a river. And this guy was pressing, and he was pressing, and he was pressing against the flow of the current of the river. And every once in a while, there were these huge party boats that would go by this guy that were going downstream. They had to put no effort in flowing with that stream. They didn't have to work like he had to do it. They just enjoyed life. They were relaxing. And every once in a while, they'd look over and mock at him. And so the guy just kept pressing and pressing. But in this vision, I saw this man grow weary. And I saw him put up the oars. And because he was moving, he still had momentum and can still went upstream. But all of a sudden, because that stream was so violent, he came to a stop. And then all of a sudden, now he started drifting downstream. And now he is flowing with the current, even though he's still pointed upstream. And then in the vision, what happened was I saw another party boat coming by, and this party boat also was pointed upstream. The people in it were relaxing and having a great time. And when he saw that they were pointed upstream and his boat was pointed upstream, he decided to join with them, and that's how the vision ended. What is the interpretation of this vision? The river is the world. The rowboat is our human bodies that we need to operate and function in this world. The man in the rowboat is definitely a believer. His oars are the unmerited weapons of God's grace. The party boats represent those who are joined in one purpose. And the river's current represents the flow of this world's system. By the oars of grace, he was able to resist the current. His physical strength, which represented his faith, began to grow weary. He didn't think he had what it took to finish. Are you with me? Because in order to accomplish our God-given destiny, we're going to have to go against the flow of this world system. Because to bring forth what heaven wants into this earth, there's going to be resistance, because the earth's flow, which is according to the prince of the power of the air, is directly opposed to the flow of the kingdom. But he didn't think he had what it took, but he did. But he put up the oars. And when he did, he kept moving upstream because of existing momentum. But here's where the dangerous part came in. This is where deception sets in. Because what he was doing to make progress was no longer propelling him, but he was still making progress because of momentum. All of a sudden, he came to a slowing stop. And if you've ever experienced this before in a rowboat, and you've been going against the current, if you put up the oars, you don't recognize when you stop going upstream from momentum. You all of a sudden come to a stop, and then you start flowing with the river, and you don't even realize you've done it. This is called deception. Are you with me? Now he's flowing with the current, flowing with the world system, even though he's still pointed upstream. So he still looks like a Christian, knows the talk of the Christian, goes to church, pays his tithes, but now in reality he's flowing with the world. Then all of a sudden another party boat came down, but unlike the other party boats that were pointed downstream, they were pointed upstream. When he saw they were pointed upstream, and they were flowing with him, he jumped on and became one in purpose. Now the deception became even greater, because now we had a group of people living the same way. Are you with me? So, consider what the Apostle John says in his letter. He says, the world, in all of its wanting, 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 is on the way out. But whoever does what God wants is set for eternity. The vision depicts three types of people. First of all, the unbeliever, who is completely oblivious to his motive of wanting, wanting, wanting. The other person it depicts, the second person, is the true believer, who must relentlessly press to advance the kingdom. Remember, Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, I press toward the mark. Are you with me? But the third person is the deceived. He's the one that hides his motive of wanting through Christian appearance and misuse of the scripture. After getting a real understanding of this vision, the writer of Hebrews, what he says in chapter 12, verses 12 through 15, really made sense to me. He says this, lift up your tired hands and strengthen your trembling knees. Keep walking on straight paths. Guard against turning back from the grace of God. This was written to believers. After hearing the vision, I think we can understand that. Would you agree? As children of God, we should desperately want to finish well. Can you say amen? Amen. So let me give you the definition of relentless. Let's just start out with that. Relentless is defined as this, as an attitude or a posture that is resolute, persistent, unyielding. Simply put, it does not relent. What does it mean to relent? To relent is to become more lenient, to slacken, or even concede. Synonyms of relentless, I always love looking at synonyms, are adamant, rigorous, persistent, uncompromising, unstoppable, tenacious, and single-minded. Doesn't that get you excited just listening to the definition? Relentless can apply to an unyielding evil force, but for our discussion, we're going to keep it positive and apply it in a godly sense. Therefore, we will apply it to one who is valiant, courageous, who is determined to complete the task at hand. Whether it's a short term or a long term, the one who possesses a relentless heart is one who's in it to the finish according to the desired end. Nothing will deter him or her from the desired goal. Amen? Now, you may right about now be thinking, but John, wait a minute. I am not resolute. I am not unyielding. I've got kind of a history of giving up. Well, let me tell you something. Nobody in this room can talk more about that than this guy. I remember when I came back from college, my sophomore year, and I came home and I told my mom, I said, Mom, I got born again. I became a Christian, a born again Christian in my college fraternity this semester. Now, my mom didn't share my enthusiasm at all. She just looked at me and she said, oh, so this is one of your new fads. You'll probably quit this like you've quit everything else. Now, what was so painful about my mom's words isn't what she said to me. It was the fact that it was absolutely true. I quit everything. I remember when I was in high school, I used to be scared that I'd never get married because I'd date a girl and after one or two dates, I was tired of her or she was tired of me. And I could never have a relationship. And I'd watch other guys start dating these girls and have great relationships and end up getting married, some of them. And then it wasn't just dating, it was also sports. I remember, you know, I did track and field. It lasted one season. I did baseball. It lasted two seasons. I remember I did golf. It lasted one season. I remember I did basketball. It lasted one season. It was with musical instruments. My mom had me play the piano. I remember after the first 3 months, the excitement of it wore off. And for the next 4 years, it was pure drudgery. And the only reason I did it is because I was having been made do it by my parents. But then my piano teacher, let me tell you this, my piano teacher did this for a living all of her life. I was the only student her entire life that she went to the parents and said, would you please let this boy stop playing the piano? So I took up the guitar after that. That lasted 2 months. I took up special interests, things like astronomy. My telescope ended up in the closet collecting dust. I went into special interest things like Cub Scouts and all that stuff. And I quit it after a year, maybe two. I'd start a book and never finish it. So in reality, what my mom was saying to me was 100% correct. Would I give up this newfound faith? Would my Bibles end up in the closets with all my other special interest things? And would I quit this within a couple years? Well, I can happily say now it's been over 30 years, and this man is more passionate now than he was when he talked to his mom. Amen? So if God can build a relentless spirit in this guy, he can do it with any of us. Amen? Because I was the chiefest of quitters. Amen? All right, so Let me just read to you Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. The apostle says, let us run. Everybody say run. Let us run with endurance. Now, endurance means this, relentless persistence. Let us run with relentless persistence the race that is set before us. Now, isn't it interesting that relentless is the single virtue that he points out that we must have to finish the race well? I'm talking about our Christian race. Are you with me? Notice he doesn't say, let us run with happiness. Let us run with joy. Let us run with purpose. Let us run with seriousness. Now, all those things are important. But the one virtue that he points out is that we are to run our race this life with a relentless spirit. Amen? That's why this series is so important, because it takes a relentless spirit to finish well. You may be facing adversity in your family, in your marriage, in your employment, in your business, in your school, in your finances, or your health, or most importantly, in your reaching out to reach a lost world for Jesus Christ. But let me tell you something. Your situation may seem utterly hopeless, without solution. Intimidating, exhausting currents may be trying to force you to give up and drift downstream. The good news is, Jesus said in Mark 10:27, with men, it is impossible, but not with God. For with God, all things are possible. Can you say amen to that? Doesn't matter what you're facing. But let me tell you this, Jesus put a qualifier on this in Mark 9:23. He said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. So it takes a relentless believer, everybody say believer, to see the impossible become possible. That is what this message is all about, facing what is beyond your human ability, and by God's grace, seeing the impossible made possible. Amen? So to begin, I want to look at one of the most potent scriptures in the entire New Testament, all right? Now, let me say this, between now and lesson number 3, it's going to look like I've diverted from the path, but believe me, I have not diverted one ounce. What I'm about to say for the rest of this lesson, session 2 and session 3, is absolutely crucial to building a relentless spirit. Romans 5:17, this has become one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible, says, all who receive God's abundant grace, everybody say abundant grace, and are freely put right with him, will rule in life through Christ. Wow. Notice he doesn't say rule in the next life. Now, if you look at the NIV, it says reign in life. If you look at the Weymouth translation, it says reign as kings in life. I like to say kings or queens, because the girls are every bit much involved. Amen? Oh, I could get off on that one for a while, but I better not. Now notice he doesn't say you're going to rule in heaven one day. Do you see that? He says you're going to rule in this life. Everybody say this life. This life. Now let me give you the definition of a king. A king is one who is, king or queen, is one who is supreme or preeminent in a particular sphere. The word reign means dominance or widespread influence. So to reign as a king or a queen is to have supreme dominance and influence over a particular sphere. What sphere is it? It's called the sphere of life. So in other words, life's not supposed to be ruling us. We're supposed to be ruling it. Amen. There is a default statement that I've been hearing for years and years and years, and I want to blast it right on this first session. Whenever it seems like things get out of control, adversities coming against our family, against loved ones, things that seem to be just much bigger than what we can handle in our ability, we come up with this statement, God is in control. How many of you have ever heard somebody say that? Come on, talk to me. Now, this statement infers that there's no reason to fight opposition because God, out of his loving and good nature, will somehow turn all adversity around for ultimate good, since he's the one controlling everything. Well, let me tell you, God is not in control the way these people are inferring. Now, some of you are like ready to walk out the door right now. I can tell. Now listen and hear me out, all right? Psalm 115:16 says, the heavens are the Lord's heavens, but the earth he has given to the children of men. Did you hear that? The earth he's given to the children of men. Let me read it to you out of the Message Bible. The heaven of heavens is for God, but he has put us in charge on the earth. So who is in charge on the earth? We are. If God was in control, like many people infer that he's in control, then when Adam went to take that fruit from Eve's hand, God would have come into the garden and slapped that baby out of his hand and said, Adam, What are you doing? Do you not understand what you're going to bring on your children and children's children? I mean, there will be earthquakes. There will be pestilences. There will be tsunamis. There will be disease. There will be famine. There will be poverty. There will be sickness and disease. Not even to mention, my son's going to have to die. No, God didn't do that. Why? Because God put man in charge of the earth. Let me help you. But somebody says, yeah, but John, wait a minute. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. That's true. That's true. Let me help you understand what that means. You know, I'm looking at my beautiful mother-in-law sitting down here. She's got a great smile on her face right now. And Shirley, you know, used to live in Orlando, Florida, and she was away from her grandkids and now her great-grandkids. And so Lisa and I, you know, we really wanted to get her close to us. So we found this townhome right down the street from us. And I called her and I said, Shirley, listen, we found a townhome. Wouldn't you love to come up here and work for our ministry and being close to your kids and your grandkids and your great-grandkids? And she came up. She saw the townhome. She just started crying. She was so happy. And you know, she's been a big part of our family now for the last couple of years. And I'm so glad she's here. But you know what? I bought that townhouse. Lisa and I bought it. And you know what we decided to do? Just because we wanted Shirley to feel that sense of dignity, we said, you know what? We're going to charge you a nominal rent every month. I think we charge her maybe $200. I don't know, something like that. But you know, that's her apartment. That's her townhouse, I mean. I don't go over there and say, hey, Shirley, you need to arrange your furniture like this, and you need to put this picture over here, and this is who you're supposed to have to dinner tonight, and I don't want anybody coming over here that looks a certain way or acts a certain way, and I want you to vacuum this every single day. I don't do that. You know, in all the time that Shirley's lived in that place, I think it's been about 2 or 3 years, I've never once gone over and see how she's doing it. Why? Because it's her place. I gave it to her. You see, I'm the owner, but I leased it to her. It's the same principle. God owns the earth, but he leased it to man. Are you with me? He said, hey, I'm the owner, but it's yours, and you're the one that's in charge. And just like Shirley runs her affairs in that apartment, if she calls me for help, baby, I'm there. You see what I'm saying? But if we call God for help, he's here. Are you with me? But he said, man's in charge. Are you getting this? I said, are you getting this? This is why Genesis 1 says this. God created human beings, making them like himself. He created them male and female, blessed them, and said, have many children so that your descendants will live all over the earth and bring it under their control. I am putting you in charge. That's Genesis 1, 27 and 28. Man, not God, is in control of how life is run in this planet. So the problem arose when Adam disobeyed God and turned this earth over to a new landlord. His name was Satan. And so what happened was, because of Adam turning this planet over to Satan, now things started happening that were contrary to what God desired. Sickness came in and all the other things. Let me tell you something. God had a problem. Not only was man in the hands of Satan now, because remember what Satan, Lucifer, said to Jesus. He said, all these kingdoms of the world were handed over to me. When were they handed over to him? In the garden. When Adam gave over to Lucifer what God had given to him. And so now God's got a problem. He says, I love man. I love mankind. I want him back. But he can't come as deity and get us back. Because he gave earth to man. So that's why Jesus had to come, and Jesus had to be born of a woman. He had to be 100% man, but he was fathered by the Holy Spirit, so he's 100% God. Therefore, he was free from the curse of sin you and I were born under. But if you notice in the Gospels, he's always referring to himself as the Son of Man, the Son of Man, the Son of Man. Because it had to be a man that got back what Adam gave away. Are you with me? And so Jesus did that, and the Bible says in Colossians 3:2:15, that he disarmed principalities and powers. And now he alone possesses the authority that Adam relinquished. This is why he clearly states in Matthew 29, all authority and power of rule in heaven and on earth has been given to me. One day, he's going to restore all of nature as it was before the fall of Adam in the garden. But as of now, nature's still subject to fertility. Our physical bodies still grow old and they die. The physical world is still corrupt and decays. Wild beasts still hunt and eat weaker animals. Snakes still possess poisonous, vile venom. Disease still runs rampant. Hurricanes and tornadoes still destroy, and the list continues. However, and here's the good part of this whole session, there is one who has authority over all of it and can turn it around, and that one is Christ. Can you say amen? Amen. Come on, I need a bigger applause than that. So, the question now becomes, who is Christ? Now, this is where unrenewed minds really gets believers. Because when people think of Christ, they think of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Almost as if Christ is his last name. But let's see what God's word says about Christ. 1 Corinthians 12:27 says, "Now all of you together are Christ's body, and each one of you is a separate and necessary part of it." Did you hear that? Amen. Jesus is the head. We're the rest. It's that simple. You individually have a head on top of your shoulders, don't you? And you've got a body. Do you refer to your body differently than your head? Austin, run up here. Where's my second-born son? Austin, I'm so proud of this young man. Come here. This is Austin Bevere. Everybody say hi, Austin. All right, this is Austin Bevere, right? I'm so proud of this young man. Now, let's say Austin's walking by a big wall and you see that head. What are you going to say? There's Austin. Isn't that right? Now, let's say he's walking by another wall and this wall is high and it covers his face. Now, when you see that body right there, you're going to go, hey, that's Steve. There's Austin. There's Steve. No, this is Austin Bevere. This is Austin Bevere. Jesus Christ, our Lord, is the head. We're the body. So who is Christ? We all are. Thank you, Austin. Are you with me? I said, are you with me? So when you read Christ in the New Testament, you need to see yourself in the mix. Not just the one who died on the cross. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11 says, "For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one." Jesus prayed this prayer. He said, "I don't pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may be one in us." Talking about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We're one. We are his body. We are Christ's body. We are Christ in the earth. That's a good place to say amen. Amen. Peter writes, "We've been reborn by the word of God so that we might be partakers of the divine nature." Just as Austin's hand has the same molecular makeup, DNA makeup, as his face, we're the same as the head. We have been made partakers of the divine nature. Do we as a church really believe this? I mean, are we really walking this earth as Christ's body? Or are we figureheads? Because let me tell you something right now. We will never, never rise above what we believe. So I'm challenging you. I'm closing this session out. Is Christ's body divided? Is the head one part and the body is inferior? Or is he one Christ? He's one Christ. We're one with him. Believe me, it had nothing to do with what you and I did. It all had to do with his unmerited grace. But his unmerited grace has made us partakers of his divine nature. We are Christ in the earth. Amen. We'll see you next session.
Amen. Can I get a little bit of music on the background? Go ahead and stand, everyone. Let's go ahead and close up. So that's a pretty good message, isn't it? That's what we're doing on Wednesday night, so you haven't made it, you're missing out. I mean, if you're doing other things, you're missing out, because it's been an awesome, awesome study that we're going through, and it's awesome to also have time to discuss it and go through it. But, so basically, Think about what boat you're in. Are you in the boat? Are you going against the flow? Are you staying with Christ? Or are you giving up and flowing with the stream of the world? Something really to think about today. And the Lord very clearly showed me that this message needed to be heard this morning. And you need to know also that grace is the power to never quit. It's the power to never give up. It's not a covering. It's the power to never give up. It's what we need so we don't quit. So we don't stop rowing. We don't want to look like a Christian and be in the party boat. Just going with the flow of the world. And so, I hope that this stirred some really good challenge in you. I know that the first night we did it for the class, everybody's minds were blown. They literally had no words. I tried to ask questions and they were just like, we just got told. So enjoy being told this morning. He's an amazing God. And he's relentless for you. He went to the cross for you. And he wants us to be relentless in our faith and to not give up, not give in to the struggles, not give in to the fear, and not give in to what this world offers, because ultimately it's a lie. And God has something so much better for us. And this morning we're going to choose to stay in the boat and keep rowing upstream. We're not going to give up. Right? Amen. Okay, well, I'm going to go ahead and pray you guys out. So let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you for every person in this room. Lord, we just lift you high in this place. Lord, I just speak over their life that they will live a life of being relentless. Lord, I just speak power and grace into their lives this morning. That they will be relentless for you, Lord. That they will not give up no matter what. They will not give up on their relationship with you. They will not give up on letting you be the Lord of their life. Lord, I just speak strength and a relentless spirit over every person here. That you will give them what they need to never give up. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the power to never give up. We thank you that you call us to be relentless. And we thank you for the cross and what you did for us, Lord, so that we could live a life of freedom and have that in our life, Lord. Lord, we thank you. We praise you this morning. I pray a blessing over every person here. I pray that they would chew on this word, Lord, and it would truly minister to them. We praise you and we glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so reminder, we're going to go ahead and tear down. Reminder, next Sunday, there's no service. Please go to revival if you can. Also, this week, we still have groups. We have Wednesday night, Relentless here. And then Thursday night, men's and women's groups. And youth, they're doing their last night at the pool house. They're going to have their study and a pool get together. They have food and everything right down the road here. If you need the location for that and everything, just talk to Pastor Zach or Pastor Becca, and they'll give you that information. Also, a reminder, if you feel like God's calling you to help sponsor Pastor Matt or anyone on the worship team to go to the school, please give that to Jason or do it online or however you want to do it.